Any minute now.
Hey, can you get a little quieter? You're making a lot of noise. I can hear you.
Well, you're in the same room with me. Of course you can hear me.
But, I mean, I can really hear you. I mean, oh, wait, shh, shh, shh. Quiet. Here we go.
Oh, okay.
Here we go. Live from downtown Houston, Texas, it's the Ginger Snap Wednesday Show, co-hosted by Sammy and his gecko friends. Of course, he always has his gecko. Hello, Sammy. Ginger.
Hi, John. Hi,
Whoa,
Sammy.
Oh, look at that fancy painting behind you.
I know. Is that not just awesome or what? All right. That is one of the paintings I did from my trip to France some years ago. And it's done on a round canvas, which is kind of neat. You don't really see a lot of those in the art store anymore. It's really nice. I mean,
how big is
that? Out of the way here. And that's a 36-inch round canvas.
Wow.
John.
I didn't know that.
And it's a painting of a boat in France. And I mention that because we've been doing a lot of flowers lately. And we're going to talk about ropes tonight and how to paint ropes. You'll notice that on that boat, if you kind of zoom in toward me a little bit, can you?
No, not with that camera.
Not with that camera. Okay, so can you see behind me over this shoulder that those ropes that are there on the boat? There's some bumper things hanging down and then a pile of brown ropes. And then there's some ropes going up the mast, different ropes. Being able to paint, you know, ropes is, if you like nautical scenes, being able to paint a rope is kind of key. You know how to do that. And so tonight I'm going to break down the pattern of ropes for you and show you a very simple way to paint them. And then you're going to go, oh my gosh, this was so easy. I don't know ever why I thought that was hard. And then of course you'll be less impressed with my pictures. You're going, oh my gosh, that was so easy. I was so impressed with that. Now not so much, right? But that's okay. That's okay. Sometimes when you know how something's done, you can either make a decision to do it or not. How's that? Again, you know, sometimes I'll look at a painting and I know how to do it. And I think, you know, there's like 30,000 hours in that painting. I know how they did that, but I don't want to spend 30,000 hours doing whatever that thing is, right? So maybe it's just that you know how to do it and decide, you know, I never want to paint a rope in my entire life. This is it. But now you're going to know. But how would you know unless you make the choice, okay? You've got to
go for it,
right? So come on down to our, did I introduce you, John? John Little, our
executive
producer?
I'm nobody important.
John's running
all the
cameras. He worked on the cameras. He sets everything up, and I asked him to set up this backdrop behind me tonight. This was sort of tricky to get this hanging up so you could see it, but I'm really pleased you do. Sometimes people just think I paint flowers, and you know, paint a lot of things. So here we go. If you're new to this channel, I'm an acrylic painter, and what we're talking about now is that I want to show you today. I just took, I found just Google search some rope. Okay. And then I went ahead and just didn't do all of the ropes, but I went ahead and just did a few, okay? And then I was running across this picture, and I thought, isn't that just gorgeous? Don't you think that tackle, block and tackle is so pretty? Don't you love that? I absolutely love that. And I thought, this will be the best example of what we're going to paint tonight. So I've got a 9x12 canvas right here, and we're going to paint this block and tackle and rope on the canvas tonight, okay? That's what we're going to do tonight. And I'm going to show you. We have some very simple colors that we're doing. We have ultramarine blue and phthalo blue. And you're going, why we're doing brown ropes? I don't get it.
And, because
that's
ginger.
Okay. You know, because it's me. And so there's never anything that's just all that straightforward about colors. Okay. So we're going to take some burnt umber here. I'm going to put some out. And I want to say that I spent probably, I want to thank you guys when you leave these live shows and you come back and you comment. I probably spent another hour and a half today writing everybody back, and I'm not complaining. I really appreciate it. Your feedback means a lot to me. Really
does. Well, speaking
does.
Of feedback.
I printed that out downstairs and forgot it. Do you have it up here?
Oh, yeah. Okay. Let's think about the comment. What did you just say? I printed it out downstairs and left it there. Do you have it? Let's see, I'm upstairs, you're upstairs, Sammy's upstairs, geckos are upstairs. No.
He has really good grasp of geography, doesn't he? You got it. John always knows where he is. Well, I thought perhaps I had sent you a copy too, did I?
No.
He's going to run down to the printer and get it. It's not fair. Because we had a comment tonight that was
needs to be shared.
That needs to be shared. You know, and I don't know why. I'm not a negative person, and you know that, right? So I'm going to, but I have to share this comment. We'll keep going on if John gets it. All right, we want burnt sienna, And cad red medium, we want those colors. This is the normal, people always say, would you put the colors up in the front that you're gonna do? You know, we do the same colors all the time. I mean, this isn't rocket science for us, you know? I just give you some colors, we pretty much do them, right? I mean, this is what we do. And that's okay. If there's some weird, unusual color that I'm gonna suggest you go out and buy, but I don't want you to have to do that. You just have these colors, you should be set. And, you know, titanium white, we're gonna want that. And, you know, some zinc or mixing white. And for those of you who want to know what the difference is, I don't mind telling you again. You know, some people think that they ask the same question over and over again, I'll be annoyed. I'm not, because when I was trying to learn computers, you know, back in the 90s, when we got some computers, and my brother was living with us at the time, and he was very good with computers. And he'd show me something, and the next day I'd ask him about it, and he said, well, I told you that yesterday. And I'm looking at him going, yeah, this is today. So what that you told me yesterday? This means nothing. I don't remember what you said yesterday. And then he'd think if he just said it louder, perhaps I was just deaf or something. If he just shouted it, you know, we'd get it. This is not how I learn. You shout at me, man, I'm just done. I can't do it. So I learned by repetition, by writing things down and by doing things over and doing things consistently. So that's one of the things I try to do, is say things over and over again, because there's going to be some people who aren't going to remember. She said it. She was talking about a lot of things and it's gone. So there it is. Mixing white is a transparent white. Zinc white is slightly more transparent. Titanium is like my hand. You can't see through it. It's like pure, you know, it's white. And professional acrylic paint in white is better than student. It's got more paint in it. It's got more junk to make it
more
opaque. More pigments, okay, to make it opaque. Now, do we have to get too technical here? I gotta read you my comment, okay? Because, you know, if you're new to this, one, I'd tell you to subscribe now, then you'll hear about the live shows. There's a little
bell.
There's a little bell down under the subscribe sign, and then if you push that too, then you'll get a notice little in your box in case we come on a time you weren't expecting. And we want to shout out to all our friends in Norway and England and France and Italy who are staying up late to watch us. We're sorry. This is when we can come on, right? So, hi, you guys. Thanks. All right. So
no, wait. Where was that comment? Which lesson did that comment come on?
This comment came on the park bench lesson.
Just so you have.
And I want you to know I didn't delete it. I didn't ban the comment user from the channel. I left it up because, I mean, it was almost an honest question. I mean, here's somebody that hears me. You know, I tell family stories, and you know, for some people, you got to understand there's a language barrier in some cases. I don't know where this woman's from, and this person's from that wrote it. My English might not be the first language, but whatever she heard, apparently, even though she enjoyed the lesson, she was pretty offended. So here's what she wrote. She wrote, "Some of the human beings have few, but others have great imperfections. Why don't you paint your mother's imperfections? You seem very sure about it. And you share it with the whole world. Are you a mother? Are you a good mother?" That's what she wrote. And at first I'm going, oh man, ladies, you're in for it now. And then I had three breaths, calm down. This is a question, you know, who knows? You know, language is a funny thing. Have you ever noticed it's hard, jokes don't always translate from language to language? Okay, so here we go. So this is my reply. And I think I got to tell you that when I tell these family stories, I edited out the bad stuff, you know, and you're thinking, man, that was you edited out the bad stuff? Yeah, I did. You know, I'm just telling you some of the stuff I think is kind of funny. But here's what I wrote her. "Actually, I'm the Art Sherpa's mother, you know, Cinnamon Cooney. You would have to talk to her and ask if I am or was a good mother. I can tell you she is a fantastic mom to her children. She's sober and not an abusive alcoholic, and I don't drink either. Being adopted by a woman who seemed to rarely have a sober evening, I suppose I see her a bit differently than her friends did. Let me say this, she had five adopted children, and not one of them came to her funeral. And as adults avoided talking to her after 5 p.m. when she started drinking. She lived to be in her 80s, and it's a wonder her liver held up that long. However, she was an artist and was the right person for me to have lived with, and I think that the contrast helped me to be a better artist and mom." So there you go. So that was my answer to that. And wasn't trying to be snarky. I was just trying to answer that sometimes I tell these tales about the family because, it's kind of like, who doesn't like a good soap opera, right? But I'm telling you what, I edited out the really scary stuff. And if you got my birthday letter, you got the bit where she tried to kill herself on my sister's birthday. You know, that's in the birthday surprise video if you missed that one, right?
And so, there's another surprise for you.
Yeah. So I'm just saying, there's some stuff that happened in our family that, is worthy of a book. All right, so that being said, let's finish putting out our paint. Sorry if I got carried away here, but that was sort of and I gave Cinnamon a heads up warning. I said, I hope you don't get any bad feedback from this, but Cinnamon is a terrific mom. I think she's one of the best moms I know, and I tried to be a good mother, considering that that I was sort of going by make it up as you go and Ozzie and Harriet, right? They seem like nice people. I tried to be more like them. Then I found out that that wasn't even true. Man, I believed it. I thought people lived like that. There were people in this world that lived and never fought and seemed to have just total peace and harmony.
Yeah, Beaver's parents.
Yeah, leave it to Beaver's parents. I wanted to be that lady. And, really wasn't, but that's who I thought I would be. That was my ideal, be a nice person. So, show up for events. That kind of thing. And if your kid's doing something, show up for it. Those things. All right, so we also want a color called Burnt Sienna. That is a reddish brown color. And we're doing ropes. That's a reddish brown color. And if you haven't, you need to paint your picture. This is a 9x12. It needs to just be painted burnt umber. I'm going to have to dry that. You see where it's shiny? It's still wet. Did you know that?
It's
shiny. John did that for me. John painted that for me.
Yeah,
so I could
I
go
know
down
how to paint.
Answer some more comments. He painted the back for me.
So see? I can say now I'm an acrylic painter. I've done it.
Sorry. So anyway, I'm going to suggest just for practice, you find something like this and just practice with it. See if you can't figure out how you might do that. Let me just take a hairdryer for this. And do we have any questions or comments, John? Anything that
Yeah. Have you ever thought about writing a book or a screenplay about your life?
Well, I have because, I haven't even told you that there's a good possibility that I'm the daughter of Albert Einstein. Did I ever tell you that?
You never know.
Yeah, you never know. I mean, there's a story there in itself, but that's going to start the chain rattling, right? I'm like, oh my gosh, now she's really lost her little mind, but naturally, not so much. So here we go. I'm going to...
we're assuming that's plugged in.
Try this. Is it plugged in?
Yeah.
Yeah, there it goes. I'm going to dry this real quick so we can get on with it.
Well, I thought she was going to do a little bit more painting on the other rope, so she changed some gears a little bit. Needless to say, I don't have anything loaded up to show you guys yet. Hey, I do want to remind you that the birthday gift giveaway, either on the website or the downloadable, is only in effect until the 28th of February. Then it will be going on sale for $11.95. Even to members, they will get a discount, though, if they ask for the discount coupon prior to the to purchasing it. Once you've purchased it, we can't give it, we can't really help you out after that. What subject have you painted the most? I would say, she can answer that one. What subject have you painted the most?
What subjects have I painted the most?
I'm thinking water. Something
probably
to do with water.
Probably water and street scenes. I used to paint an awful lot of European street scenes. For one, for a lot of years I had an agent, which was really fun, and she would, every week I would be painting huge paintings for her, something different. When I had a publisher, which I had three or four at one time, publishers, and then, they get stuck on something, kind of like authors, like for instance, Stephen King is a marvelous author, but I don't think anybody want to, if it wasn't a horror story, people don't want to read it, because that's what he's famous for. And, authors get sort of stuck in ruts, and artists do too. So once somebody kind of globs onto you, then they sort of want you to keep doing that. But I did an awful lot of, I spent some time in Europe and did a lot of European street scenes at the time and did a lot of that. And I like water scenes and boats and stuff. And I want to show you this painting. This was one I did in Europe. This was one of my ones.
Make sure
check at
room.
This. Can you look at this? Can you see it?
Let me back up a little bit.
See? Now, just this right here, if you can zoom in real close on it, John. This right here, do you see the texture on this? Can you see it?
Yeah.
See how textured the sand is?
It looks like real sand.
It actually is resin sand, and it's actually a medium that's sand and stain. And then look at the block and tackle, and look at the rope. Okay, is that not cool? And this is a Hope and Peace is the name of this painting called Hope and Peace. And I love that. And these were two boats that were also in southern France. It's a companion piece to the one behind me. So this is one of the reasons I wanted you to learn how to paint ropes, was not that we're going to teach that as a lesson so much, as that I want you to be able to do stuff like that. And the ropes might just be the thing that held you back. And you might decide, oh, well, there's a rope there, I'm not doing it.
Okay. Is there a real difference between acrylic brushes and watercolor brushes?
Oh, gosh, it's night and day difference. Night and day difference.
So like, I knew that answer.
Yeah, there is. The difference between watercolor brushes and watercolor brushes are often made of sable.
They're very soft.
And they're very soft, and acrylics are going to practically destroy them. You know, acrylics brushes need to be synthetic. They need to have a certain spring to them. And one of my biggest complaints, in fact, I'm coming out with a new book. We'll let you guys know when it's available. And one of the things that my big hot button is the fact that you'll see packages of brushes, and these manufacturers, bless their little hearts, they want to sell to everybody. So they put it in a package where you can't touch it. You know, it's behind cellophane. And then they say watercolor oil and acrylic brushes. Well, it's either one or the other. It's which one? Because they're all different, okay? And if, you know, and you just don't know what you're buying until you get them home, and then it doesn't work with acrylics. And a lot of times your problems with acrylics, the problems that you're having as an artist with acrylics, are your brush sucks. It's the wrong brush. It doesn't hold any paint. And then you do something, and like, I don't know, it works for her. Why doesn't it work for me? It's like that guy with the $40 window squeegee. Have you ever seen that guy? He's out there, you know, washing
beautiful
windows
job.
With the squeegee. And he has a job, and you're looking, and you're in the house with your $3 squeegee you got at the grocery store, and you're in and outside the window trying to get the spots off, and it's not working. And this man comes along, and the window's clean. Well, isn't it that he's better at a squeegee than you are?
He's got a better tool.
You know, it's just that he's not using newspaper and Windex. You know, he's got something else going for him, right? So, you know, that's what you need to do as an artist. Your tools are everything. That's where you need to, you know, if I were to say, would I rather have a good brush or better acrylics, I'd start with the good brush first.
Yeah.
Bottom line, I'd start with the good brush first. And I got to tell you, I heard from our friend Sylvia. Let me draw this in as we're painting this, okay? So I'm just going to do like this and just draw this in.
Closer.
I'm going to sketch this in here. As we're doing this, I heard from Sylvia, our gal in one of our members in Australia. All right, and I absolutely was thrilled that she was able to get a hold of the brush guys in the States, and because she was saying that the same ruby satin silvers were just so wildly expensive in Australia. Okay. So then what she was able to do was to buy from those guys. And so I wrote and said, well, how much did you pay for them? How much was shipping? That was the main thing. And sure, she paid the same thing as you and me. But the shipping, I was wondering, how much did it cost her to ship? She got like $100 worth of brushes, and instead of $30 for one brush there in Australia, okay? And she said the shipping was $25, plus she got used the code GINGERCOOK, all one word, and then she got a... her little discount, right? So let's put this one over here like this.
Hey, Ginger, we'd like to have you give a shout out to Marty's mother of almost 85 years, first time viewer.
Oh, hi, Marty's mom.
Her name is Alice.
Hi, Alice. Oh, I'm so glad you're watching. That's absolutely cool. You know, I was reading a story about a gal that was 80 that had gone on a mount, you know, gone to the base camp of Mount Everest, and I always tell myself when I'm climbing the stairs, well, it isn't Everest, it's not Everest, you know, walking up the stairs. And John's making snarky remarks about how long it takes me to get up the stairs. It's not, I just take my time. I just want to make
you
sure
enjoy the journey. You're looking at the mountain scene as you're going.
I'm imagining Everest going, oh, thank gosh, I'm not on Mount Everest. Right? that was really brave, wasn't it? That woman was brave. Anyway, thanks, Allison. Glad you're coming. All right, that was great. And so let's see, I've got a kind of a fun rope coming out of here like this. Do you see that? And it's coming up here like this, and then it makes the curve, and then comes underneath like this, and twists out here somewhere. We don't know what happens to it. Just does this somewhere off of here. Sounds good to me. Does it sound good to you? And then we've got this other rope that's twisting around here and coming this way and down into this. There's a hole here. Look at that. There's some sort of hole here that comes down like that. And this is almost straight across here, like that. Ooh, like that. Look at that. All right. So basically, that's the picture. All right. That's our picture. All right. Sounds good to me. All right. So we'll just get our stuff out and knock this out, shall we? Don't you think that'll be fun?
I can't believe you just sketched that just freehand without even...
Well, this is a... I mean, think about it. This shape here is a box, right? John, this is a box. Does everybody see that? That's a box. Okay, so I mean, this wasn't a particularly difficult shape, okay? And then this is an oval, okay? And this is a straight line, and this is a line that comes up out of this hole right here, which is a good thing you mentioned that. This comes up out of this hole, comes up a little higher here, like that, and then goes back down, like that. So I mean, if it's kind of wrong, I mean, who'd know, right? It's not like anybody's that familiar with these things, you know? Not like hands where, you know, if you're missing a finger, people notice. It's just what happened to that person, you know? Okay. What person? What was there supposed to be a thumb here? Well, I don't paint thumbs. I'm sorry. I just don't do thumbs. Sorry.
That's got to be it.
That's got to be it. All right.
So it couldn't be your years of experience of drawing, though, could it?
I got the water over here. Did we get the brushes from last night?
Oh, you wanted brushes too?
Yes.
Jeez.
John, it's a family show. I did family show here.
I did my background with my own little brush here.
Of course you did.
It was a cheeky little brush.
Yeah, okay.
I didn't use over.
Yeah, okay.
That's
what
I used.
All right, good, great. Yeah, thank you. We got some brushes, we got a rake, we got some stuff. We're going to paint this. Now, normally, I sketch this on pretty quick. I normally would have done the whole background first, you know, done all this junk first, but we didn't. So let's just put a little, let's just start with the hard stuff, right? Let's just get that done. All right, so let's take some white paint and some brown paint, some ruby satin, a little bit of yellow oxide. Let's see. Let's move all this over here so you can see it. Somebody was suggesting last night they would just be happy as a clam if they could see the palette. So how's that? So... Since this seems to be our mission this week is to keep clams happy, there's the palette, you know. We don't know any clams personally.
We don't want them sad, though.
But we're very concerned about clams. And so there we go. This is a ruby satin silver half-inch brush. And we're over the dark brown, right? Then we're starting there with this little beige color. And then we're wrapping this around like this. And coming back under here. See why we like these? Because there's a sharp edge to it, okay? And then this is sort of coming around like this and like that. Oh, that works. That works. There we go. And then there's some sort of little dark line right here. And then what happened here? Something happened here. I may not have given myself enough room. So I'm getting a little bit of blue and white with my brown and coming right here like that next to this. It's just I'm using it the width of the brush. I decided that's the width I want. And then there's a little bit of a dark spot right here. Then I'm going to wipe the brush. Here's the deal. You got to be able to wipe your brush off, okay, as we're painting along here. I hope this isn't too boring for you. I mean, not everybody wants to paint a block and tackle. I just personally think that's really pretty, right? I mean, to me, that's just gorgeous. So, you know, it may not be your thing. And it's okay if it's not. You can just hang out and chat with us and say, I hope she gets back to flowers soon. What's with the block and tackle? Oh, my Lord, did you see the black and... Oh, my gosh, I can't stand that, right? Where's the flowers?
What are the sizes of the ruby satin you're using right now, please?
I'm using a half-inch ruby satin silver brush.
And that would be one of those diagonal cuts?
Diagonal angle short handle brush, right?
Hey, aren't you having surgery tomorrow in your left eye?
I am having surgery tomorrow in my left eye. I'm trying not to think about it.
Sorry, no, I didn't bring that one up.
Yeah, well, you know what? It went well for the first eye, and you know what I mean? And I'm sure it'll be fine.
Yeah.
But
no more rainbows around the moon.
No more rainbows around the moon, you know. So we're saying goodbye to that. And, you know. And then the other thing was, oh, listen. Did I put phthalo blue out? I didn't. Well, what kind of a deal is that?
And you're blaming me for the brushes.
Well, I wasn't blaming you, John. I was just suggesting that one has an art show, having brushes to paint with is rather handy. Don't you guys think so?
I thought we were going to do finger painting.
I know, John. It's just a little confusing. It's tough being old, right? Just getting old, get a little confused. It's okay. We're with you.
I remember finger paint. Just remember finger paint? That was so much fun.
It was fun. Don't. But, you know, have you ever seen my hands at the end of the show? I don't think I really gave it up. Do you think so?
Hey, somebody's asking who are the brush guys?
The brush guys are a company. I think they used to work for one of the major paint companies. They're two guys, and they went together, and they decided that they could sell all the brushes, you know, the major manufacturers of brushes, and only sell brushes and give everybody a better price. And they give great service, and really, they're really marvelous. And you get your brushes right away. And so both my daughter Cinnamon and I use them. We use them because we like them. Now, I have brought brushes from other people. They don't have every brush there is. There are some brushes you have to get from somewhere else. But generally speaking, my feeling is if you're not familiar with a brush, unless I've told you to get it or some, you know, like that, if you haven't heard a recommendation, I would want to see the brush in person. But once you know you have a brand of brush that you like, you know, and you're well, you know, then you got a shop price. And they give us, if you use my code, the Ginger Cook, they give a 5% discount, which I thought was kind of, you know, very generous of them. Don't you guys think so? Yeah. And they give, you know, so here, let's put this down like that. Okay, so we're getting there. See, little block and tackle thing here. And, so, all right, so we know that that's where the, where this, the rope's going. So I'm just going to ignore the rope for now. I'm just going to paint in my block and tackle, and then I'll deal with the rope. See, you couldn't do this with oil or acrylics. What I love about acrylics, and you know, which is just puts to me hands down above oil paints and stuff, is that you can just sort of layer on as you go. You can think about something and go, you know what? I think that that's what I want to paint. And I'm going to paint this right now because this makes sense to me. And the trick is when you're painting something, you've got to break down the pattern so that just simplify the pattern. You see how we're breaking down the pattern? You can kind of see what I'm painting here? You see I'm breaking it down? And I'm breaking it into layers and just knowing that there's a light and a dark to everything. And I'm breaking that down. And as we're talking, and as long as I'm into that color, I'm just going to whip over here. Put a little white with that in brown. Put a little purple. Purple kind of gray stuff too. There we go. Purple, grays, yellow. There we go. Let's just make this. Let's see what how purple just changed that into a nice soft tan. I'm going to put this other part of the... So which is the block and which is the tackle, John? This is called block and tackle. Which is which?
Well, the piece that you said was the block that looked like a block?
This one?
Uh-huh. What do you think? Do you think that would be the block part?
I don't know.
I'm just going out on a limb on this one.
Is this a trick question? I mean, just tell me the answer. Don't try to get cute with me. Just tell me the answer,
right? Just trying to educate you. Hey, did Ginger teach Cinnamon how to paint?
Cinnamon watched me paint growing up. And she was awesome. She was good at it from the day she started, which was about a baby. She just was good at everything she did. The problem with Cinnamon is that she's good at everything. I mean, this child can do everything. I mean, she's good at sewing. She was making her own outfits, you know, just with the sewing machine when she was young and you know, like in middle school. And she could, and she would paint things and she won all kinds of awards. And she was publishing her cartoons in our horse magazine and NATRC Horse Magazine, and she was really talented. She was just extreme, and she still is, by the way. She didn't suddenly lose her talent, really. And so, you know, did I teach her to paint? Did I influence her to paint? Yes, I probably influenced her to paint, but I a lot, and she watched me paint, and occasionally I would make suggestions. You have to be kind of careful with your kids, and here's the deal. You know, have you ever heard the expression? Maybe even heard it somewhere. Prophets never honored in their own hometown. Ever heard that? Appreciated in their own hometown. I think Jesus said something about that about his parents or something, right? And so, you know, as a parent, you have to be kind of careful because if, you know, when I would teach other people, you know, or you know, I had a, you know, your children know you too well. You can't lie to them. You know, so if you tell somebody, maybe it's some other kid, you're going, that's nice, right? You're lying. You don't like it. Well, I do. I can tell you. I know you. You hate it. And, you know, you have to be very careful what you say and how you teach it. And to nurture painting in a child, you have to. There's a lot of times where I see this, particularly with when I teach painting parties. They'll go to a painting party. Mom will bring their kid. And the kid knows the mother slightly better at them. It pretty much is, right? And so at some point, the mother will feel obligated to paint on the child's picture. And, you know, all trying to be helpful, you know, not trying to be mean or anything. You know, they paid all those big bucks to go to the painting party. And then the kid's in tears by the end of the evening and not having fun at all. And everybody wonders what happened. My best thing is to do is that, you know, give them the materials. Let them have at it because they're very sensitive to judgments. You know, kids are. And, you know, particularly when your mother's a professional artist like I was, you know, you got to be kind of careful. So I tried to give her the materials. Her dad taught her stuff about, her dad taught her how to drive. I didn't teach her how to drive. And the driving lessons were 200 ways not to drive like your mother. Your mother does this. I never want to see you do this. And I don't know how he would know, because it seems to me he was always driving. I was never driving when he was in the car. It's been so many years since I'd driven with him. But anyway, he was always behind the wheel. But anyway, that was sort of funny. But, she got driving lessons from her dad, and she probably got some art stuff from me. But she was always just really good at it, absolutely good at it. And in college, she was art and architecture student of the year. She won't brag on you, but I will brag on her. That's what she was, art. And I don't know if I have room for the rope here. Did I leave room for this rope? I might have to bring this down a little bit. I have to think about this for a minute. I don't know. We'll leave that for. I have to think on that. We'll leave that dry. All right. So but that's my thing for parents. And you know, if you're grandparents, you know, get them the stuff, and just tell them they're doing good. And let them do their thing, because they want to do, you know, it's a learning curve, and it's amazing how fast they can decide that they don't want to do it. You know, no parent is deliberately trying to offend their kid, but it's amazing how, you know, fast. I just watched kids just go into total tantrums at the painting party places because, you know, their mom said something. Now we're using a little bit of phthalo blue here. We're just using a little bit of blue on here on this tackle thing. This
apparently,
is the block.
Here's a comment from Australia. If I told my husband I was painting a block and tackle, he would be very concerned about what I was painting or who. It has an interesting meaning in Australia. Well, okay, you're going to have to go to contact us and tell us what it means.
Yeah, yeah, and if it's blocked, I'll approve it, because we all want to know, right? If YouTube blocks it, I'll approve it for sure, because now we all want to know, what is it you said?
This is need-to-know information here, folks. Come on.
Yeah, we all want to know now. You know, you started something, haven't you?
Yeah, you can't just say that and walk away.
No, right? You can't say that. But it's funny how language has the different, you know, does have a different aspect of, you know, depending on, you know, where you're from. You see what I'm doing here? You see how acrylics dry darker? I want to get to the rope part, so I'm not trying to spend a lot of time on this, but I think this is kind of a pretty painting. I mean, I think this has the potential for being a really pretty painting. If we're just sitting around here tonight doing live stuff, I may just finish it just because I like this picture.
It's the background that's really pulling you in. I know it is.
It's the background. It's that old wood, and it's the rope, but I wanted to show you how to paint ropes. And when that was my thing. Just, you know, could I show you how to paint ropes, and how would that be? You know, like that. You know, it's just this light back here.
Oh, a hint from Australia. It is a guy's equipment.
Really? Really?
I don't think we have to go any further than that.
Well,
I
want to know what is this called in Australia then? These little rope gizmos things, which I know you got boats. You know, everybody's got boats. So you must call this something.
Rope and a pulley?
Rope and pulleys?
Probably. That's safe.
Well, it certainly would be, wouldn't it? Right?
That's interesting.
So that's so interesting. It is. I mean, you know, language is a funny thing. I mean, like when I was going to boarding school in Switzerland, our teacher was from Wales. And so when he was speaking English, but not my English, right? Not English I'd ever heard of, right? And he's sitting there saying, "Do you have any cotton wool?" And I'm going, "What? What are you talking about? Do you have any cotton wool?" And he was talking about, you know, absorbent cotton, you know, little cotton balls.
And you called it cotton wool?
Cotton wool, huh. Yeah. Called it cotton wool. Well, yeah. But, you know, sometimes language is regional, too. Have you ever noticed that, John? It's regional.
Yeah, that's true.
Not just country to country. It's regional.
I did
competitive trail riding for many years with my horse, and I remember going up. And we'd get a trail ride briefing. If anybody, you wonder what that is, you take a horse and that you get a map and you have a day and you have times to be at certain spots and you get, your horse is then judged on physical fitness by veterinarians, because it's not really so much as a race as like a cross-country event, and they get judged on manners and all kinds of stuff, okay? So I was doing competitive trail riding and we're at the map briefings and they're saying, listen, you turn left at the Mater Stakes. And I'm raising my hand going, I'm sorry, I guess we were in the South somewhere. What are Mater Stakes? I'm sorry, that was just a big puzzle to me. And they said, tomato stakes. You know, the stakes you put in the ground for tomatoes. Mater Stakes.
Mater Stakes.
Of course.
That kind of sounds like Ohio to me.
How could I have missed that, you know? And then it was, there was another one, I loved it. And we were in Colorado and doing a trail ride there because we took our horses, and Cinnamon took her pony, and she almost won the President's Cup. I won it the following year, but she almost won it on her pony. It was really pretty fantastic. And with this briefing, and they said, they're telling us hazards on the trail to watch out for, and they said, watch out for the corduroy. For the corduroy. You know, like corduroy pants? And I'm going, okay, hello, back here from California. We Californians, what is corduroy, people? And
what is corduroy?
Corduroy is what they refer to on the trail as when you're on a muddy trail and there's a lot of jeeps and vehicles go on it. They put logs going crossways on like this.
You know, give them the traction to go through it.
And the logs are real close together like this, and they're called corduroy. But a horse could get their foot caught in between
big
them.
It's
fine for a jeep, and then squish their foot.
It hurt.
Well, break a foot, you know.
That's true.
Which is, and then my thinking is, well, what do you mean watch out for the corduroy, and then do what? You know what I mean? As opposed to what? I mean, now I see it. Now what am I supposed to do? But, you know, I guessed, you know, trying to be nice. And it was really kind of a whole thing annoyed me, but what can I say, right? I have to put some yellow out, cadmium medium. I wasn't going to, but I am.
Oh, you wild person.
I know, just going crazy tonight. I'm just losing my mind here, putting some yellow out. So anyway, the upshot of that was that there were a lot of things that they had like that. Turn left at the tank. And I'm thinking there's a big tank, you know, like a metal tank. And it was water was just a hole in the ground with some water, like a pond, you know, like most people would call it a pond. That would be the term for it that most of us on the planet would have used for that if one spoke English, you know what I mean? So there were a lot of those, and I almost, you know, is that colloquialisms, isn't it?
Yes.
That's a good word, isn't it? Colloquialisms.
Oh, that's a great word.
Colloquialisms.
Hey, I just arrived late. Is Ginger planning to do the wooden plank background? Is there a reason she didn't finish that first? What's going on?
I should have finished it first. And it's a good point. Good
point. Good observation. She was just so excited
about
the block and tan.
Nobody's slow in this group. I mean, we got everybody's really smart here, aren't they? I'm telling you what, and I'm not being snarky. I mean, you're absolutely right. The background should have been painted first.
Is that ultramarine blue that you're using tonight?
I've got ultramarine blue and phthalo going.
Oh, so what have you been using? Both of them?
Yeah, both of them.
No figures.
You know, both of them, you know,
you
like
can't
that.
Make it,
I just wanted to get, what I'm trying to do is get you to see the rope. Which we're trying to get to. But I had to get far enough along with this so we could actually have a rope. Yes?
Yes.
That's all. I wanted to see, you know, guess we're going to paint some boards in here like this. You know, absolutely. We're a big fan of that. We like these old boards. In fact, this would be where that crackle would come in. It would be really good, that crackle stuff, John.
Yes.
Did I buy any of that? I can't remember.
No, we didn't. No, because it was golden, and golden wasn't on sale.
That's right.
You know, we have to be as penny wise as our members are.
Yeah, so, you know, if somebody wants me to demonstrate their stuff, they can just send it to me, you know what I mean? But I was thinking about it. I had, you know, so, all right.
Yeah, I wanted to see it. I wanted to see it on the mask. I wanted you to do another mask and try it on that.
Well, I may still, I may still get some. I may still get some, but for sure, I may still get some. All right, so one can spin. Yeah, you're right. There's paint back up here like this. There's all kinds of stuff in the background. But, I wasn't so worried about this background. I'll tell you why. Because it's something you can kind of, you can, because of the way this is done, does that make sense? And because of the way this is done, you can kind of add the background as you go. So, you see, I can put some background in here and get it to go. That would have been nice to have had it all at once. I absolutely agree with you. That would have been by far easier than the way, but that's okay too, because sometimes you need to put like a little shadow or something under here and you want to make sure you have that. And, so let's put these in here, these little dots in here like that, and something up here like that. When you're painting things like this, what I would tell you to do for it is that it's very important to look for where the lights are. You know what I mean? What's lit on an object and what isn't? You know what I mean? The shape of things and the lights, and the light and dark areas of something. The little highlights sometimes make all the difference in what something looks like, when you're putting things in like this. But the main thing I wanted to show you was how to do this rope. That was my main thing.
Now, this is a 9x12 stretch canvas.
Yeah, it's a 9x12 stretch canvas. And, when you're starting out like this in there, and I really appreciate your comments because you're right. It would have been a far swifter on my part to have to put in the background. But on the other hand, it's not that hard to put in either. You can just keep putting it. It's probably a good place to clean your brush. As you get a little color on something and you need to, you see me wiping off a brush on something, and I can, so I'm always putting layers of color on stuff, like that. Let's see, let's pull this. The back of this is sort of rounded. It's not square here. The back of this kind of comes around like that. And it's light back here. And then there's a big chain. I don't know if we'll do the chain. You're kind of getting the idea, though. And already it's looking kind of cool, isn't it? And let's see a little bit of purple. Purple, grayish, yellow. Did you guys know that? And why is that? Because yellow...
Get that famous purple color wheel out.
It's opposite purple on the color wheel.
Or as Lynn would say, I was looking all day for my gray wheel.
Yeah. You can get you can get a separate grayscale, too. You don't have to have that with the color wheel. You can get a separate grayscale. And let's put some of this down here like this. I'm just still using this half-inch brush, but it's pretty good, right? We're getting there. It's already, let's take a little orange and kind of red and yellow and make this orange color.
Why did you move to Texas and what is it like compared to California?
When I first came to Texas, I thought I needed an embassy. How's that? It was so different. So different. For one thing, it's very hot here. California was hot, but we lived near San Diego. I like Texas. I've lived here since 1988, so I must have liked it a little bit, or I would have left, right? Not saying I don't like it. Look at that. See, look what happens when you start adding a few highlights. Isn't that funny how this little thing is coming together? Aren't you sort of surprised a little bit now? I just think it's sort of interesting how this is coming together here. Just with color like this. This sort of slopes down a little bit, and then that's a little darker down here at the bottom, and then comes up like that.
Tell us a story about moving to Colorado with Cinnamon's dad.
Well,
apparently Cinnamon mentioned something.
Well, Cinnamon's dad, I met him skiing on a ski trip when I was in college. Okay? And that's a great story. You know what I mean? That's a great story about Cinnamon's dad. And Cinnamon's dad was an interesting person. Very smart. Gosh, couldn't, you know, Cinnamon's smart. And, you know, he was really smart. You know, if you're just going to make kids with somebody, he was a smart person. You know, you get a smart kid with somebody like Colby. He's very smart. And I think John would have liked him. I think John would have enjoyed Colby. He's not dead or anything, but I think you'd like him if you ever met him. He's a little eccentric. He's so eccentric that it's, and he's, gosh, how old is Colby now? He's getting up there. Not talking about me, but he's like, was 10 years older than me. And he was one of those people that could eat one potato chip and then give everybody else heck because they couldn't, you know? And I can remember going out to dinner with him and Cinnamon. We'd go to the pizza place, and he thought everyone should have one piece of pizza. That was more than enough food for anybody. Why you'd need two? For a long time, he didn't consider pizza food even. I remember, well, he came from Wyoming. They didn't have pizza when he grew up. They just ate sheep or something. I don't know what they ate. But his family had a sheep ranch, and he was kind of isolated. And he had, you know, and I didn't realize it at the time. I just thought he was weird. He actually had Asperger's. Very strange person. And, you know, you're just, you know, you have to appreciate when you live with a mother that's an alcoholic, Asperger's isn't a big leap for you. You just work around these things. And you say, so what's a person like that's like that? Well, we have the same thing every day for breakfast. You know, I just wanted scrambled eggs every day for breakfast. That's what he wanted. And which was fun, you know, just that's what he wanted. And he had to have certain foods in the house or life was very unpleasant. He couldn't deal if it didn't have certain foods in the house. Let me put this rope in and we'll tell you more about Colby Cinnamon's dad. And he was just at IQ about 175, just really, really smart. And all right, so I'm going to come across here with some tape. Where's tape? Okay. Not this tape. Let's see, let me back up, see if I'm finding some tape here. Yeah, here.
The smaller stuff.
Smaller stuff. All right, you with me? Here, let me put this brush down. So Cinnamon's dad, when I met him, he was like 10 years older.
Do you need to dry anything?
No, because I'm just measuring. See, this is a straight, can come up a little bit. It could be up, but it's still straight. Does that make sense? It has to be straight. So I'm not really going to tape it. I just need to know what straight is. Does that make sense?
Oh, you're still drawing. Okay, so that's your ruler.
So I'm using that as like kind of like my ruler here. Is that, you know? Because chalk wipes off. Okay, so there you go. That's good enough. I just needed to know what straight was. All right, so that's considered straight. All right, so we're just going to come across this. And he didn't read people very well. He really couldn't read people. It was hard for him with friends and stuff because he really couldn't read people very well. But they, you know, he could get along, but he really he was clueless as to, you know, how.
Houston,
you know.
We've got a problem.
Huh?
We dropped out for a second. I think we're back.
Are we back?
Yep. It was a quickie this time.
Oh, good. All right. So they're saying there's this. It goes down into this hole back here. Well, I kind of missed it. It actually goes up here a little more. Let me just, all right, new plan. It's going up here and then down here. Okay, I can fix it. Then it goes under here like this. Like this. This is where this rope's going. Crossed here like this. All right. Okay, so let me just dry that real quick, John.
Okay.
Because I need it dark, but that's all I need it for, okay?
Okay.
All right.
All right, while she does that, I want to show you a mask that was sent in by Robin. This was from the, not the Valentine's. We're still on Valentine's, right? Mardi Gras mask that we did, the blue mask. Kind of like that one. And another one that we had come in, Pansies by Victoria. I got those two for you this evening. Those look pretty good. And Ginger's back. Let's bring her back up.
Isn't that pretty? Don't you love that? I think I love that. You know, all the colors in that pansy painting. That's one of our tutorials. Okay, so ideally speaking, this should come out a little bit further. I've got this This block needed to be up here somewhere, but it's what we're dealing with, all right? So if I did this again, I'd change it just a little bit, but that's okay. So now what you have to appreciate about rope is that you need to have things curving like this. Does that make sense? It needs to curve like this. This is the whole thing I wanted to get to with the rope, all right? And then at this point, it does this. It's like an S lying down, all right? Now, do you see that? Now it's like an S lying down. That's the, and then this one's turning around like that. So when you're painting it in, all right, you start with something dark, and then you come up here like this, and then you do the light thing, and then you skip a space and do another light thing, light ropey thing here like this, and then skip a space. I'm kind of like that. You see what I'm doing here? And now it's starting to elongate out. And when you're putting this in, the rope in, it's bumpy. It's not a straight line. The top of this is curved a little bit. The top of this rope has got a little bit of a curve to it. And then it comes in like that. And I think I need the other, if I have a smaller brush, let me try this one. Put that one in water. All right, so now I'm coming up like this and then back down. See that way, like that. And I'm leaving the dark crack in between. This is why I painted it dark in the first place. This is what I wanted to get into, was just to paint this rope so you guys would see it. So you just paint the rope in like this. And so here's the angle. Here's the angle. I chalked it in, not for exact where the rope was going to be, but so you get the feeling of the angle of the rope, what it has to be, all right? So then here's the next one, like that. It's lighter. Let's need some titanium white. And then it's layered. So this is my first layer of rope color, all right? And so I'm just generally outlining. This is almost like a sketch at this point, see? And then, as I dry it, then I'll start adding more colors to the rope. Rope is really fun to paint. Okay? All right, see it's coming along here. There's my rope. And up here like this and down, and then it's kind of coming around this way. And then it's tucked in here somewhere in that block. See, already it sort of looks like a rope, doesn't it? I mean, isn't it kind of?
Yeah, it does.
So there you go. So this is our ropey thing, and then it's very dark in between here, in between these stuff, and then there's a shadow that's coming on this side of it. See, on that little light thing you did, there's a shadow that's coming part of the way. And I'm using just a bright brush here, a short-handled bright brush. And already it's starting to look more like rope, okay?
Are you able to paint every day, and how do you overcome a creative block if you do?
Well, you've got to appreciate it's not just painting every day, but what I've got to do is figure out something you guys can paint every day. Because if I'm not painting for YouTube, I'm painting for our online lessons. And they generally tend to be a little bit more complicated than what we're doing here, okay? And then I'm trying to find pictures that I think would be interesting to paint. People are going, well, you sure lost it this time with this stupid rope. I don't know what you're doing with the rope, lady. But anyway, you know, that's my goal, all right, is to find you guys stuff that's interesting to paint. See my rope? See how it's already coming in better? We haven't done much, right? Now, while this is drying, okay, meanwhile back at the ranch, while this is drying, okay, let's come along here and put this cross piece in right here, like that. There was a little cross piece in this tackle thing here. This was the block, right? Yeah, okay. All right, there's the block, and then this is going down into there. Okay, like that, all right? So now, remember we said wherever there's a light, there's a dark. So then right under this ropey thing here, it's a shadow area, right? Makes sense, doesn't it? Where this rope is going into here, like that's gotta be in shadow already, that put it into the hole. And then there's a shadow across the top of this. The rope is creating a shadow, right, like that, see? So that's got to be dark right there. And then under here it's dark. Do you see that? Because it's going across there. And let's put a little, if you want, ultramarine blue and burnt umber make a very good dark color. So there, see, it's dark under there, okay? Dark here, and then really, really dark under there, and then there's a little corner here that's dark, where this is, where it's going in, see? And then we got a little bit high here, so we'll just erase that, okay? So it's coming along, yeah? And then, like, under here, where this rope is, it's dark. Okay, so I have to bring this tackle part down, I will. Like that, that's darker right under there where the rope's going in. And so then I don't quite have that drawn correctly. So we're drawing as we're going. But see, you couldn't do this. If this was a watercolor oil, you'd have to have a much better drawing than I started out with, you know what I mean? What I love about acrylic paints is that you can just bop along and then make corrections as you go. You just don't sweat the small stuff because it's all small stuff. Okay, is you can just paint over something. There you go, see? There's that happened there, and then this was dark. This was dark in here like this. Under here, and then really dark under here like that. Okay? So there's the rope kind of sneaking into the into the block, and then let's thin this up. Oh yeah, we gotta bring this down a little bit. So this has to be a little bit wider down here as it makes the curve. But we can do that, right? And there was some purple in it. I remember that. I saw some purple. Anybody else see the purple? I see in purple. So there's some real pretty purple in here. Maybe purple and white. There we go. There, let's do some of that color. That's neat. Some purple in here like this. There we go. Just to bring this down like that. So how do you get creative? One of the things I do in the, you know, one thing to get creative is get happy. If you're in a bad mood, it's tough to be creative. So I'd say the first thing to do is get happy. And if you're having trouble finding things to be happy about, just make a list of something that's kind of going right. I would say that. I can't say enough about the positive aspect of getting happy when you're trying to be creative. Listen to happy music, pet the dog. We don't have a dog, but if I had a dog, I'd pet it. You know, that kind of
thing. We have a bear instead.
We have a bear. Well, John has a bear. Well, we have a bear. Of course we have a bear.
Hey, is this similar to painting the handle on a basket?
Yes, this would be very much like painting a handle on a basket. See? No, we haven't put the highlights on, but let's just do this back rope while we're waiting for this, right? Can you see how this... I think this is really pretty. I'm loving this.
This picture kind of fits in with the farm genre, like a barn and chicken and tractor.
Well, it could. In other words, knowing how to paint certain things can be very useful. All right? I think so. And so we're just still painting the... we're still painting our wood floor, you know, for sure. We're still painting that. And let's put a little purple with that and tone that down. You know, remember, yellow is toned down by purple. See? I mean, we're still doing stuff. All right, so I need to paint this. So I'm going to take it very dark, and I'm saying that this rope is coming out of here and this end like this. My chalk is all wrong, so let's just lose the chalk because it's so wrong it's confusing now at this point. I've readjusted everything, so the chalk's wrong. But this is why we do chalk. All right? Because it erases. See? Race. Yeah? Okay, now. No more chalk. That's much less confusing. All right, now we're going to take something, you know, some purple here. Oh, instead we do that, I know what let's do. Let's lighten up the floor here. Let's just come under here like this. Purple and yellow. Like this. Let's just do this back like this. You're right. It would have been better to do the background first, but we didn't, so... Better is not necessarily best, it just would have been nice. How's that? Okay, so here's our background that we're going to put in a little bit of gold in here like this. Just using the flat of this brush like this back and forth. Let's just erase that too. Where'd that go? Here. I don't know what this is, but let's just get rid of it. All right, wonderful. There.
Will you be doing any Thomas Kincaid soon?
Thomas Kincaid, yeah, we'll do some more of that. Thomas Kincaid, and somebody asked for some English cottages. So Somebody asked for some English cottages, which we'll be doing. Yeah,
we got a couple already on the design table.
We do, and I've got this really, for our members, I've got this great picture. We should show you. There's this, people love the lady in red. You know that one? So we did, this is from another one of these old dead artists. Hey, this is an important thing. I know I was talking about Cinema's dad, but I digress here. We had a woman write me and ask me what, you know, why would she want to take lessons from, you know, join our art gallery of fine art? What would be the benefit? Wouldn't she end up just painting like me? And I'm one of the few artists that I know of that do not teach you to paint like the artist. I mean, if you're doing a Bob Ross painting, and you're going to paint like Bob Ross. I mean, because he had a style, and Bob Ross learned that from this other guy, and he painted like him. But what I try to do is, thanks, John. What I try to do is teach you to paint like you, and how you do that is by step by step learning how to mix colors, how would you tackle a picture like this? We just sat down and started knocking this out, and I want you to see how you do it, how you'd break up a photograph and that kind of stuff. And we try so many different things because everybody has their own style. Some of you do very well with impressionism and some of you don't, and you try a bit of that, and it's not like you should even know how to paint. You should know enough about how to paint this stuff to decide that you don't like painting it. That, you know, you're more of a photorealistic person and not an impressionist. And that's got to be okay. It certainly is with me, you know. But again, how would you know unless you've tried it? Yeah? Do you understand? And so what I try to teach on our website, this is getting pretty. Come on, I'm loving this already. We haven't done much. I got to dry this background really for a second so I can put the thing on.
We're at the point that I'm down to the Garden Pathway personal art coaching.
Well, I'm talking about 2 minutes of drawing.
Two minutes?
Maybe you could tell them about our new search engine on the website.
Okay.
Just wait to hear about this. This was thanks to Wendy Goodchild, found this for us. Thank you, Wendy.
Okay, what she's alluding to is on our website, gingercooklive.gallery, we now have a search capability. You put in a keyword or just any word that might describe the picture. It's a Google search engine. Go through our website and we'll find it. There are advertisements on some of the searches at the top of the list. They're in a different color background, so you can tell where our stuff comes in. But you need to give that a try. It's up under the library lesson menu item, number one on the list. And photorealism, what is it, Ginger?
Photorealism is where you take a painting and it's so close to the photograph that people can't tell the difference between your artwork and a photograph. How about that? That's what photorealism is. So it's kind of neat, right? So I'm going to come up here like this, and I'm just going to make one line instead of drawing it out. I know I need to come up here, and it curves, and then it curves down like this, and then comes over here in some sort of a little knot thing like that. Let's see if I like that. All right, so that's what I want it to do. See, all right. Now I know that, so I'm going to take some burnt umber and purple, and I'm going to come out, straight out of here like this, and over my chalk like that. And this is where I'm going to say I want my my rope to come. See, I'm doing it in purple now. Now I'm going to slide down here and then make it fatter here. All right, everybody's with me? Like that. You start off with the darkest color, the color that's underneath, right? And then we're just going to come out of here like this and like that. So that's going to be, let's put a little bit of blue and burnt umber in there too. Make sure I've got this nice and dark, and it's coming out of here like that. Now that's where my rope's coming from. If you started this and you didn't know that's how you started, you go, well, I don't paint ropes. Look at this. This is a hot mess. I don't paint ropes. Well, this is how you paint them, okay? So, good to know, right? So let's see, let's put a little bit of dark, as long as I'm waiting for that to dry. Now I've sort of drawn that in, so I'm doing a little bit of dark under here like that. Okay, under our block. And let's see, let's put our little dark things in here like that. Those little dark things, there's a little place for a screwdriver, I guess. I don't know. Just imagine it's a screwdriver thing. Okay, so there's our little thingy. Now, while I'm waiting for that to dry, I could dry it, but I'm going to just keep on going here because I think this is really pretty. Let's just take a little bit of mixing white and yellow now, and I want to come right here on the top of this, wipe off my brush because it's been in the water, so I'm going to really wipe it off, and then back here with the mixing white and yellow oxide. And just want to come up here like the mixing white didn't do it for me. All right, there we go. Like that's better. Here's the top of my rope. Like that. Dry, just barely touching this, you guys. Barely touching it. Make sure that the top of the rope here, each little loop almost, if you think about it, like a loop, is curved. Like that, see? Now, as I bring it down a little bit, bring it down just a little bit here like this on the, like that, just on the inside. There we go, a little bit here like that. Okay, and then it's curving around this way. It changes curves, it changed like the letter C, suddenly becomes like a letter, a C. Everybody learned to draw when you learned handwriting. So you have to decide if what kind of letter it is. But now, isn't that just cool looking, right? And then I can come back with some dark and still do a little bit more of the shadows on this side. A little bit of burnt umber and purple and brown. Come this way with it like that. Make sure I've got the dark. And remember, your chalk wipes off. So if you've got chalk here, you can get rid of that. And then right under here, right under this rope, where the rope's crossing over the block, it's dark, right like that. The rope's crossing over the block, all right? So, all right, so there it is. Now, is this dried enough yet? Maybe, we'll see. Now, this one is going, and if you have to, put your, see, it's curving like that. So put your lines, if you're not sure, and then it changes direction and goes this way when it crosses over. It starts going under this way. So when you're painting something like this, sort of, you know, be aware of what it is that you're painting. Put a little yellow ox. Let's put a little white with that. You know, like that. So be aware of what you're painting, the direction that you want stuff to go, and how bumpy you want it to be. Okay. And let me bring this down a little bit closer to me like this. All right, now when I come to the top, I'm just going to sort of just paint the top of it and not try to get too clever with the curvy stuff. All right, like that. So there's that. Now, there isn't enough contrast there for, I kind of lost some of my contrast. So I will just put it back. A little bit of dark here like that. Just put the contrast back. And then when I come the other way, now the other, and this rope's a little smaller. When it gets over here, it's the background, and you can look at it, it's not quite the same size as wide as this other stuff. But I'm going to just cross over here a little bit like that and paint this in. And come around like that. So what was the question, John? You were asking me something, and I'm just sort of focused on this. I forgot what the question was.
Oh, I didn't remember what the question was.
I don't either. Just stuff getting old. I don't remember what the question was. You were asking something about something.
Well, apparently I was. The last thing I thought was we mentioned was photorealism. I think that was the last
photorealism.
Thing we did.
Yeah, that's what photorealism is. And in fact, there was a lady we were reading about her today. We won't mention her name, but we were reading something about her today. And years ago, as an artist, she would be selling her paintings, and people wouldn't, you know, over the internet, people wouldn't buy them because they felt that that was a photograph and not really a painting. And that she just, you know, touched up a photograph. And so she started doing speed paintings so people could see that it actually see her paint it so she could sell her artwork, because otherwise it wasn't selling. Now that to me is extraordinary. that would
speaking
even...
of selling, we had an email come in, and people want to know if they paint one of your paintings, can they sell it?
Sure. I want you to sell it. I want you to sell it and buy more art supplies so you can paint more stuff. Oh, yes. Wouldn't that be great?
The only thing we don't allow you to do is make prints of that and sell the prints. They have to be all original.
You can't, and you know, it's just, you know, you can't go license that to some print company and say, oh, that's my artwork. But you know, here's the thing: if it's an old dead artist, yeah, I guess you can. There's no copyright on anybody before 1900. If I haven't changed it, then just whatever you want to do.
It's yours.
Yours.
You created it.
Yeah, anything that's over 100 years old is copyright free. So pretty much all bets are off. But now if I take, you know, Van Gogh's Starry Night and put it in his field of sunflowers and do something else,
that's yours.
An original piece. It's not like anything he painted. Maybe I took bits of his, so that would be an original piece. But if I'm doing a blatant copy of somebody, when I do a lot of those, you know, not because I'm, you know, people say, well, what's the point of copying? Did you know that every great painter that you admire copied the artists before him, and that's how they learned? Guess what? That's how they learned.
Velazquez
painted in the 1500s. He was one of the Spanish foremost painters. And Picasso, Renoir, Monet, all went to the museums and copied his stuff to learn how to paint. And some of them actually made, kind of supplemented their income painting the old masters. Because remember, we consider them the old guys, but there were old guys before them.
And old guys before them.
And then old guys before them.
There's always old guys to copy from.
And this is how art is learned. You know, you can't teach a good idea. You know what I mean? You absolutely can't teach a good idea, which we understand that, you know, you can't teach a good idea.
I think you need to finish your story with Cinnamon's dad.
Oh, Cinnamon's dad. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I knew that I was talking about something. Cinnamon's dad. Well, anyway, I met him on a ski trip in Aspen, and we got together, and I'm not going to tell, I've told that story before about how we got together, and I rode my motorcycle to Aspen to see him, and you know, all that stuff.
Go look through all our videos to find
that
story.
I've kind of told that story, but isn't this rope looking kind of cool now, you guys?
Look at
that.
Great.
One of my favorite stories of Cinnamon's dad, I got to tell you this, even if I told it again, this is one of my favorite stories. You know, Cinnamon's dad had, and his mother had, well, he got, I don't know, it's a family thing. When they'd eat their cereal and stuff, they'd clank their teeth with their spoon, you know? And I remember, we hadn't been married very long, and I remember us sitting there and... And the other thing he'd do is he kind of slurped his cereal and clanked the thing. And I'm thinking, we haven't been married very long, and I'm thinking, 50 years of that. I don't know if I can do 50 years of slurping cereal and clanking the spoon on the teeth, you know. I like him, but, you know, this is asking a lot. So, and you got to appreciate, I had just turned 18. I was really young, and he was like 27. He was a lot older than me. And so I said to him, do you suppose... that you could do me a favor? And he says, yeah, what's that? I says, do you suppose that you could not slurp your cereal and clank your spoon on your teeth? And he goes, sure. You want to take the scrambled egg off the middle of your forehead? We never talked about that stuff again. That was it. We never discussed it. But I've still got scrambled egg on the middle of my forehead, don't I, John? I mean, that hasn't changed, right?
Nope.
I'm sure he still clanks his spoon. You know, we just don't talk about it, right? We do not talk about it anymore. All right, so here's my lights. I'm coming back here with my lights here on my rope. Come on, this is just cool. Isn't it how you paint a rope? All right, so that was funny. We know that was some of the funny things. I think about that now, and it was kind of humiliating at the time, but it was funny. What can I say? Let me do one little thing here. I mean, I love this. Don't you love this? I think this is so fun. I mean, if you wanted a block and tackle picture. All right.
I'm going to take
a little burnt sienna and a little water and glaze over this just a little bit and kind of turn this. See what I'm doing? Just kind of a little burnt sienna here and just sort of glaze over the bottom of this. A little bit of water there like that. See, and just sort of... There, now I can take some white and you know, just you know, lighten this up a bit, this rope, just a couple places here like that. And you want to make sure that you've got this curving at the bottom. It's got to really curve. You got to get that curve going with the rope, this down here, that sort of loopy curve, that's real important. See, like that little curve thing? That'll really make it feel like rope. Anyway, so Cinnamon's dad was a pill. And bit of a challenge. Trying to think of some of the weird stuff he did. All right, let's take a little bit of... Now we're going to start adding some color to this, okay? I want to start getting a little bit of, you know, oranges in here and some colors. I made a little bit of an orange. Now that I've sort of... I feel like I've got my my rope in over there. I'm going to work on the top of this one, adding a little bit of an orange color to it. Remember, your artist, it doesn't really matter what the photograph has in it. You can start... you know, adding some color to your stuff, it's okay, right? Some water there I didn't want. And that's all right. Just going to start, you know, brightening this up a bit.
How long was Ginger married to Sherpa's dad?
23 years. Sherpa's dad for a while. And, you know, we still speak. We're still friends. He came to Cinnamon's wedding. And Cinnamon and John got married at the Renaissance Fair in Texas. And it was just a most beautiful wedding. And I made her wedding dress. And it was, it took me a month to make it. And it was just, I had bought this fabric. It had hand-sewn a they're fake, but pearls all over the wedding dress and all over the dress. And it was done in, you know, kind of like princess style from like King Arthur's court. And she still has it. And she was going to college at the time, trying to do finals and getting a wedding in. And she kept losing weight on me. And I said, you've got to stop. You know, I mean, I'm making the dress here, just... eat something, please. But it was just, there was just so much going on. Look at that. There's part of this rope that goes over here. Look, I missed that. Well, we can do that, can't we, guys? There's this rope and it goes.
It should be coming out of that little
comes,
piece.
Piece comes over this way, like this.
Should be coming out of the pulley.
Well, I guess it does, but it's coming this way. And it comes that way. What doesn't really matter, I'm putting it. It's you know, I don't really have to understand it. I'm just doing it, right? You know, that's the nice thing about it. If you're just drawing shapes, you don't have to understand it at all. You just have to put them in. Here's a shape, and it's this color, and we're just going to put it in here. Like this coming under here, and it's coming under here like that, and it's coming back this way. See? I mean, that's easy to do. Now, it's true I made it purple and white, and it isn't purple. I will change the color, but I mean, that's pretty much what it is. And it's coming this way, and then this is dark, very dark.
How do you know which color to put side by side? We see you throwing colors all over the place. How do you know what to do?
Well, I mean, I can, there's a glare on this, but don't you see all the blue and stuff in this pulley and stuff? You see all the colors, right? Like right here, for instance, right here on this pulley, it's
Let's zoom in
sort
a
of a
bit
light
since
blue,
you got them close.
Like a light blue like this, right? Like this, there's a light blue. And then there's like a light blue up here in the corner here like that. There's a
so
little
you're not
this
really
one.
Doing a lot of artist interpretation on this. You're actually seeing the colors in the photos there.
Yeah, I'm seeing the colors. Oh, absolutely. I'm seeing the colors in the photos. And I thought the photo was so pretty that it didn't really need a lot. Okay? You know, I mean, really, the photo I thought was just gorgeous. And remember, wherever there's a light, there's a dark. Does that make sense? So when you're putting in colors for somewhere... You know, this looked a little bit purple right here on the edge here. This did kind of look purple to me. And right in here, so I'll just exaggerate a little bit, but that was sort of purple. And then there's a little bit of purple over here too on this side, on this like that. And then, see, that gets prettier, doesn't it? I mean, you start throwing in these colors and then that gets really pretty, you know, to me. And there was a little bit of Okay, so cad red medium and yellow make kind of an orange. So if I turn this sideways, and sometimes it helps to turn your picture sideways too. It helps. And Cinnamon's dad and I, we built our house together. We built our house. We hired a little bit of it out, but we built our house in Aspen.
Is this part of the Colorado story?
No, we'd moved to Cali. Well, we lived in, we didn't build it in Aspen. We moved to California. We sold our house in Aspen, and we took the proceeds. And in order to get a house in California, we pretty much had to build it ourselves. Okay. And Cinnamon's dad, you know, the thing was about him is that when he told me something, you know, he was enough older than me, and there had been a lot of time is that I really believed pretty much everything he said. So when he said he knew how to build a house and that he'd worked with his uncle one summer in high school building houses in Colorado, I mean, I just didn't assume he was taking out the trash while other people built the house, right? I thought he really knew how, okay? And he was really smart, and he sort of figured it out, but he really didn't know anything about it, okay? I mean, he really didn't. And so, you know, we're building a house based on the idea that he knew how to build one. He learned, but he really didn't. And when the building inspector came out to pass this, California is really tough to build anywhere because they have these building inspectors that are not bribable. Not that we ever tried. It wouldn't have occurred to either one of us. So when we built that, see, I'm just looking at the picture now, turning it upside down and doing my thing here. All right. Like this while we're painting this. I just love this painting. I hope you guys don't mind. Do you guys like this painting, or would you rather I had painted flowers? I'm just out of curious here. I mean, be honest. I mean, it's okay. You're humoring me, but if you'd rather I'd painted flowers, probably should. I'll know for next time, you know. But I want you to see how we're layering on colors here. And now we're starting to do the lighter stuff on top of this old block to make it look old. See? I mean, that is sort of cool how that's looking, don't you think? When you think about it? I mean, it is to me. I think it's kind of cool. And I'm not, you know, I'm just saying that this is where we've got the, you know, this is, here we go, like that. So I want to get a little brown here. So
I
anyway,
like
the building
painting,
inspector.
Loving this painting, love it. We learn from painting different. Love it, love it.
Thank you.
Variety of subject is great.
So the building inspector came to building to pass the laundry room, and we didn't pass. Guess what?
You didn't pass the laundry room?
No, we didn't pass the test for the laundry room. And the guy was, well, he was really rude, you know. And it's called really. We didn't know why we didn't pass. The bad thing was we had no idea why it didn't pass. Right. I mean, why didn't it pass? What's wrong with it? You know what I mean? Don't you want to know that? Even in school, if you flunk, they generally put a check mark against the things that are wrong, right? They don't just say, there's 8 things wrong in here, figure it out. It's not my job to teach you guys plumbing. That was what he said, right? There's 8 things wrong here. It's not our job to teach you plumbing.
And he didn't even give you a hint.
No.
Nice guy.
Yeah, well, he wasn't a very nice guy. And listen, they don't come out for free. You pay, back then we paid like $400 for the man to come out to flunk us.
Yep.
Remember that? That's just really rude, isn't it? All right, so we're just going to dry brush something in here. See, like that? See, dry brush. Oh, that's so cool, isn't it?
Well, it's upside down.
But that's just neat, right? Here, back to picture. And I'm not going to put this old thing right here, though I do think that the...
That's the metal hook that hangs it up, you know.
The metal hook would be sort of pretty. Do we have time? How are we doing on time? I'm bopping around.
Oh, does time ever really matter?
I don't know. Does it matter, you guys? Because, I mean, I can put the hook in if you want to see it, you know.
Let us know if you want to see the hook. Have you guys had enough of this?
You tired of this? And
would love to see a harbor scene with boats.
Well, now you're kind of getting an idea of what it might take to do one, right? You know, and just boats and, let's turn this upside down like this. See, this is what you got to do. When you do something like that, just turn it upside down. So you see that the bottom of this has to be pretty straight, right? And what's happening is the paint's drying in my brush as well.
They all want the hook.
All right, we'll put the hook in too, but we got to come across here for the bottom of this.
Time
got to be
matter.
A little put a purple and phthalo blue and white.
A pelican okay. and a flamingo would be nice.
Oh, I found some great Paint My Photo flamingos.
Yeah, those were cute.
I didn't realize that. You know, they're pink like that, John, because they eat pink shrimp.
Yes, I do know that. I'm from Florida.
Well, you're from Florida. You probably heard that. They probably told you that when you went. What
when,
is that?
When you looked at, why are those pink flowers, pink birds? Where are they from?
Yeah, Florida. You know, they have them.
Yeah, they do.
You know? Now, there was something else here. See in the middle? See this thing in the middle?
Yeah, I do.
You do. Okay, so that is...
Do you know what that is?
I have no idea what this is. It's a thing that's in the middle. It's a thing, and it's in the middle. And it's wrecking my ball because it's in the way here. I've got this tackle thing all done, and then suddenly this junky thing pops up.
It's not junky. That's the metal that's hooked to the other end that hooks the hook on. Keeps it all together.
You've used these before, have you?
I'm afraid I've seen them before.
You've seen these before?
Yeah. It's also logical.
All right, so we're doing something like this. Andrew might like this.
I can see a 30 by 40 coming out of him with this.
You know, he lives on the ocean. This is very nautical, isn't it? Very nautical. All right, so this is straight down like this. Look at that. Didn't think I could do it, did you? You doubted me. And it comes down like this on the ends. Look at that. Don't you love those ruby satin silver brushes? One brush is doing this whole thing. Look at that.
You're doing the whole thing in that one brush?
Yeah, look at that.
Oh, well, I need to clean up tonight.
All right, there's that hooky thing.
There's that hooky thing.
Look at
oh,
that.
I love it when you talk technical.
I know, there's that hooky thing. And then, what else did we learn about the hooky thing? Well, what we know is that there's a little dark shadow in front of the hooky thing, right? Like that.
Was that the end of the story?
What story?
I'm not sure.
Do we have a story? I forgot.
Well,
were we telling
about
a story?
Kobe and the house and the inspector.
Oh, yeah. Oh, the inspectors. Well, we eventually passed. We eventually passed. You know, long story short is we eventually passed, okay? Now we need a little bit shadowed under here like this, just a little bit like that. Kind of back there, so not talk about that too much. All right, hook thing. All right, so you will notice that there's this curve. Now remember, we all learn to draw when we learn handwriting, right? So this comes out here like this. This is like a C. And then it does this. Okay, like a macaroni noodle. Well, you've got to find something that relates to you because, you know, you generally... And then this is curved. Is that funny? This is
no,
what
I'm
does.
Not laughing. No, I'm laughing at the comments going by. That's what it is. Yeah.
Okay. All yeah. right. Because I had
comments.
A feeling that you were laughing at the fact that this looked like a macaroni noodle to me. Because if it does, it's got to look like something to you. You've got to translate. You know, you're translating. We are translating a language, right? And it's really difficult when you're using a vocabulary you've never heard of. You know what I mean? If you're trying to paint something you don't know what is. You know, Cinnamon and I got a job one time. I can tell that story. Cinnamon and I got this job one time. And from this company called what was it? What was the name? It doesn't really matter. They installed commercial drinking fountains and made air conditioners for commercial buildings in Texas. And they wanted us to paint their let's see, there were 12, there were 36 by 48 paintings. There were 12 of them. And they all had to do with their business, everything from backhoes and all that stuff, okay? And that they wanted us to do it. So that was a job. Cinnamon was in college at the time we were doing that. We did it, and we did it together. And what we learned from that is, never take a job that you're not, don't care how much they want to pay you, that you don't really have your heart in.
Because it shows.
Well, it was like pulling teeth to get it done. It was such a challenge to get it finished. And, because really, you know what I mean? Drinking, two guys welding in a drinking fountain, you know, it's hard to make that artistic. And I did it too. And Cinnamon did it. We did it. And she did all the photography for it too. She got all the, you know, she did all the pictures for it. And between the two of us, we got it done. And she was taking commercial art in college, and you know, was, you know, for assignments in school, was painting things like hair dryers and things, right? So I mean, that was you know, wasn't the challenge wasn't that so much as it just wasn't a fun project. It wasn't fun to do. And if something isn't fun, you know, you're much less likely to want to paint it. Yeah? So, you know, you should kind of like what you're painting. I mean, if you hate block and tackles, and this doesn't just make your heart sing when you look at it, I wouldn't mess with this. You know, maybe you could just do what I suggested earlier and paint the rope. Just paint a rope. Just make sure you know how to paint it. You know, just do that. Just for on GP, learn to paint something, right? But if this doesn't make you real happy, it's no fun to paint things you don't like. And it's okay to start in the middle of something and decide, you know what? I don't like painting this. I tried it and I don't like it. I'm going to do something else. That's what acrylic paints are for. They paint over.
As a matter of fact, I believe I saw a canvas in the bathroom that you had washed off.
Yeah, I started it and I washed it off completely in a fit. Just put it right under the sink and washed it off, okay? Now, look, that's coming around, isn't it? I mean, you can see that. Is it true? That's coming around.
It's got the rust on it and everything. That's very cool.
It's got the rust on it. There's these little things that are coming out of it like that. Now, in order to make that show up, now, what's the rule? Wherever there's a light, there's the dark. So you don't see this showing up, right?
I do not.
So how do I fix that? So I put some dark behind it, and then that shows up. Make sense?
Makes sense.
So you darken up what's behind it, which is one of the reasons why there's not a lot of point in spending a lot of time on the background in a painting like this until you know where you've got to put the background. Does that make sense? So getting that done. Well, we loved living in California. I loved it. I mean, it was, you know, I came to Texas, but, you know, after I divorced Cinnamon's dad. But, I mean, I liked California. It was very nice. The climate's just beautiful. Climate is beautiful.
I think a lack of water would drive me nuts.
Well, you know, the water bill was really expensive. Our water bill was one of the highest things we had. We didn't really have much of a heat bill. We didn't have air conditioning. There wasn't any of that, but our heat bill was expensive. Okay, and you see me pinching out the brush and then adding more color here. See, like that, the bottom of this, and then making this darker right here. This little shadow right there behind that.
What part of California did you live in?
We lived near San Diego.
San Diego, oh, the zoo.
Yeah, near the zoo. Yeah, San Diego Zoo, and Yeah, it was real. It was very beautiful, and we had, you know, Cinnamon had a pony, and growing up, I had a horse, and we did competitive trail riding, horseback riding, and you know, that was fun. You know, growing up, she had a little darling little pony named Whiskey, and he was a little Shetland pony, half Shetland, half Arabian horse, and he was really cute, and he was the half brother to my horse. And and my favorite, you know, and we had some very nice, you know, we had some crazy neighbors that lived close by. I think I was telling you the story about our crazy neighbors the other day, wasn't I?
I believe
just,
so.
Just our crazy. We had these neighbors, you guys, that were so crazy. And there's this one lady that lived next to us, and we had like open range fences, you know, like lodgepole pine fences. And she had these dogs. We didn't have any dogs. She had these dogs that would roam over everybody's property. I remember she was in her 60s, and I remember June calling me up one day and saying, you know, you really should try to pick up more on your property. I said, what are you talking about? She says, when my dogs come to your place, they drag home everything, and then I don't like it that you leave the garden fertilizer out where they can take it home. Said, let me get this straight. Your dogs are trespassing on my land, and I'm supposed to tell me again, what is it you need me to do? Because this is just really such a puzzle to me. I got to tell you, right? Tell me again, right? Of course, I was a little nicer than that, but I wanted to say that, you know. I'm going, oh, gosh, great. I have to be nice here that she's my neighbor. Going, oh, yeah, that's a terrible thing. Oh, gosh, so sorry about that. You're so right. Okay, now you see how I'm lightening things up again here like this? See how everything's, do you see how we're building up this whole deal here? Do you see, you guys see that? And whenever I look at that, I say, where else can I put a color? If I'm lightening something up, can I come back here and lighten this up?
Do you plan on adding the frayed knot to this?
Over here?
Yeah.
No.
No. Oh, neither. It's kind of distracting.
Yeah, what I'm trying to do now is come in with all the lights that need to happen on here like this. I'm trying to get all the little light areas that happen here like that. And lights and darks, that's what I'm working on now, lights and darks.
And the question's coming up, what's the difference between what you're doing now and what the lessons are that you're being charged for online? Do you go into more instructions, or what's the story?
Usually the lessons that we do online are, for one thing, they're rated between, I started painting with acrylics back when I was like 16 years old, and nobody painted with them. And a lot of the techniques I have painting with acrylics are really unique to me. And so the first thing we do is we encourage you to go through a list of videos that have to do with how to make acrylics work in the way I do them, okay? And then we start, every week you get an exclusive lesson. There's over 270 lessons on our website that are exclusive. And every week you get a new one, and it may be a one cookie, two cookie, box of cookie lessons. We have all kinds of different lessons. Here's a new lesson that's coming up I thought I'd show you. Here's one that's coming up. Here's the, it's called The Reflections. This is by one of these old dead artists. We talk about a little history of art on our show too, and that's probably a two cookie lesson, all right? And that's one.
There's a lot of blending in that one.
There's a lot of blending in that one, and it's very interesting. We talk about the artist, and this was that's a lesson that came up. I don't know if we have any more, but eventually, and I can show you this. Eventually, I want you to be able to be able to look at anything and just easily paint it. You know, that would be, I would say, my biggest goal for people would be to do that. You know, to look at just anything and just be absolutely able to paint it. And you get personal art coaching. And we only charge, you know, seniors, we charge, you know, $21.95 a month, or if you're in the military. And if we get, there's $26 a month, that comes to $95 a month, that comes with personal art coaching. You can send me in your artwork and I will comment on it and send it back. Do you have an example of that, John, while I'm drawing this?
While we're letting that dry.
Yeah, why don't we let this dry? Let's just show you. That's a good question. I'm glad you mentioned it. It's a reasonable question. Why would you want to do it? There's nobody that's offering anything like it.
All right, we're going to bring up a painting by, Teresa. I had to get her name.
Yeah.
And there it is. That is what sent in.
She sent in, and here's the deal. This was our free birthday gift, and 30 more people redeemed that yesterday. You've got till the end of the month to get it. That's the birthday party. Do I have a copy of that somewhere?
Yeah, it's hanging on the wall. I'll go get it.
Thank you.
I'm just sitting around doing nothing again, you know. Watching the show, enjoying it.
All right, so she sent this in and said, do you have any suggestions? Now, one of the things I really liked about that, in my original painting, and I'll show you that here, in my original painting, I had the fence, you know, a little bit straighter, and she has it sort of bent toward us, and I actually like it better. Sometimes you guys come up with stuff better than I thought of, right? And because Teresa's a member, she gets personal art coaching with that picture, where if you're not, you get the picture and the lesson. That's a free lesson that we're giving you, but you don't get the personal art coaching. So she wanted to put, like, tulips in her picture, and so as opposed to the flowers I had, and I think you should plant your own garden any way you want it, all right? And then, so John is going to show you my suggestions to improve this painting, though I thought it was very nice so far, what she had, okay? Now here's how personal art coaching works, all right? And incidentally, here's the picture. Here's the original painting, all right? See that? There's the original painting. That's the original lesson, all right? Now, what did we tell her to do? All right. So I told her, and I gave her an example. If you're going to do tulips, give them some leaves. See that on the right? And then add highlights to the top of the rocks. And then I said, you know, she really did a good job drawing in the painting. She did excellent rocks and atmospheric perspective. That's where you push things back and make it look very far away. And she did a really good job on the, but really, honestly, this painting was very well done. Just needed a few little things to make it better. And sometimes that's all something is. It's just a suggestion on how to make it. So basically, when you're a member of GingerCookLive.Gallery, you get a personal art coach via your email, all right? So then, where's your final? Look at that. Do you see how she added the flowers to the tulips, added a few more highlights on those two rocks? And look at that. See the difference?
Now go back to the...
And that's what I told her to do, and then here's the final.
And that's her first...
There's the final. You had it a minute ago. Yeah, there's your final. And see, that's just charming, isn't it? I mean, really nice job on that. I mean, I just think that's beautiful. And that's what you get, is you get help. You don't have to live in Texas. You can live in Italy. You can live in England. You can live in Australia, and you can get help with your artwork. You can live in Canada, and you can live in, you know, we're in Texas. You can be in Wyoming, in the middle of nowhere, and you've got a personal art coach in your back pocket. And once a month, you can send me some great creation that you've done on your own, as long as it isn't one of my daughter's, okay, paintings or something like that. I don't like to comment. She and I agree with some comment on each other's stuff. And you show me a reference photo, I'll help you with that. So that's what, and you can send that in as many times as you need to get the help with it.
And again, right now, you can join for 7 days for $9.95, and you can send in one painting that you're doing during your week for the personal art coaching or the Ginger Pack, as we refer to it.
Yeah, the Ginger Pack.
Which is personal art coaching.
Yeah. That's right. Good point. Good point. Yeah.
And we're back.
And we're back. So we're back here. So let me just start. I'm doing my little.
And if you're not a member, you can certainly go and look at the gallery. You can see the different paintings that are currently available. You can do searches. You can do everything. We even have some sample lessons up there, so you can see how they actually will work on your different devices. They can be played on an iPad, tablets, phones, computers, laptops, televisions. You name it, it can be played on.
Yeah.
And if it can't, we'll figure it out.
That's it. So, I mean, I think that's sort of good to know, don't you think so? I mean, you know, what can you do with the, you know. So now we're adding a little color here. And we just started to, you know, at first, you know, we had some things on YouTube that were, you know, if you see our early stuff on YouTube, you know, it's not as involved, but I think sometimes it helps to see, you know, sometimes we do real involved things. Sometimes our lessons and our website are, you know, 2, 3, 4 hours long. You know, they're very involved, you know. Sometimes it just takes that long to paint something. All right, so we're just going to put a little color in this. Here's a little bit of, just a little bit of color on here like this.
And a lot of people do that 7-day program. They, you know, they have a week off, or they find a week time they can do during the month. And you can do that over and over again. That's not a one-time thing. We have people that come back every month and do a week.
Yeah, it's all right. We don't mind. At some point, we're going to reach a level where we won't be able to keep offering personal art coaching. We've said that before. Right now, we still are.
It's getting close, though.
It's getting close. And so the thing about it is that when you're a member, you are guaranteed your personal art coaching. As long as you don't drop your membership, you're guaranteed that.
But if you drop out and we're in a holding pattern or taking lists,
on a waiting list for that. But it's still, I mean, you know, you still get a brand new painting every week that nobody else gets, just you. You know, it's just, you know, and I think really good stuff. People that have been with us for a long time, I mean, we're really charged nothing for the lessons. I mean, if you were to take a personal lesson from me in Houston, private lessons start at $125 and go up, and classes were, you know, pricey too. And but in any event, we're trying to make it where. Regardless of where you lived in the world, it was affordable.
That was our goal.
Our goal is to
teach the world to paint.
Yeah. And John, you know, the other thing you talk about, it. What is the deal with John? You get to see how we just kind of fix that. Don't you think this looks cool, John, now?
I'm really liking it.
I mean, me too. I'm just going around putting a few highlights here and there, just a little bit of color here. I didn't put that thing back there, but I see little things where I'm doing it. This way, you know, and of course we could, you know what would be good here in the front would be a palette knife. I'm just using a dry brush here, the flat of the brush here, which is pretty, but a palette knife would have been very nice
here on the
front. Give
you a little bit more texture in there.
Yeah, you know, I like that, but I'm just sort of dry brushing so you guys get the idea of this sort of dock with this. And this still would be, this I think is still kind of a cool lesson, right, like this. And I still need to just come around here and pull something this way on these.
Now, the same technique that you're doing here on the rope could be used for doing like a carousel pole?
Yep.
A barber pole?
Yep.
Basically anything that's using this kind of a swirling pattern. A candy cane?
Yep. Yeah, see? I mean, same idea, absolutely. Same idea. Let me bring this back a little further. Because if you did a line across here, this has to come back just a touch further. Then I have it.
It's probably one of those paintings you could spend another 2 hours on playing.
Well, you know, you could. I mean, I could, and I might just, you know, at some point do it and show you tomorrow too. I could do that too and just keep painting. But, you know, this is the kind of thing where you absolutely could spend, you know, you could spend more time doing it.
Well, I don't think you're going to be doing that tomorrow, sweetie.
No, I'm getting my eye operated on tomorrow, so I'm not doing that. You're right. I'm not.
You know, I might even give you the whole day off.
Well, you know what? I might work on my book because I can dictate.
Yes, you can. Yeah. What? A book? You're doing a book?
Yeah, I'm working.
Tell
on,
me more.
I am working on a book.
Are you really?
Yeah, but not the sort of the soap opera of my life, though it's fun to tell you guys those stories. I don't know. It's almost cathartic.
That would be a
you know
novel.
I mean? You guys, it's almost my therapy. Just tell you those stories because they're sort of fun, but... I needed to shorten that up and make that longer. See, I mean, you can just come back and correct anything, can't you? There you go. Look, see, better. Yeah, better. What was
better
that?
Butter.
Better butter. Remember that?
Yeah.
Gosh, we are defined by our.
Oh, tomorrow John can paint. You think? A book?
Go.
Really? Is she doing a book?
Yeah, I'm doing a book. I'm doing an art book. Absolutely, I'm doing an art book. And I'm looking forward to it. And I've been writing it a little bit every night. There we go. Just sort of soften that up a bit here and then put the...
What sort of book is it?
It's going to be a book on painting.
Well, are you kidding me?
No, don't you think that's a good idea?
Getting out of your comfort zone a little bit, huh? Talking
about getting a book on painting, right? And yeah, I think that'll be fun, right?
It should be fun.
And it's just as long as we're just out here chatting with us, you, me, and yeah. See, I mean that's kind of cool, isn't it? Yeah. So you see, I'm still going back. Remember, acrylics dry darker. I haven't erased the tape, but I'm just kind of going back here and. Doing a highlight on a couple of these pieces of rope here. But I mean, that's sort of fun, isn't it? Our little block and tackle, you guys, don't you think that's sort of fun? I think that was a, you know, when it dries, I might just erase all the,
all the chalk?
All the chalk stuff. Now, see, I need to come back because I didn't do that.
It would be both hard copy and digital is our hope.
Yeah.
The book.
And at some point, you know, are we doing any pre-orders?
No.
No, apparently not.
That is a nightmare.
Wait, John
we did
that
with
before.
My publisher buddy and that. Yeah, we did one, and oh man, that
never again, right?
Uh-uh.
So, well, people ask, so we'll have to say.
No.
We'll
announce when it'll be published, and it'll be ready to go.
Yeah, and we'll just let you guys know. You know, I mean, just might.
Hey, will there be a book signing event?
I
don't think so.
I don't know.
Oh. Yeah, it'll be Kindle. You will want a colored Kindle, though. It'll have to be one of the Fire Kindles. I will, you know, I have all the Kindles, so I'll look on it and see what it looks like in a black and white, but it's going to be pictures, so I'm not sure how that's going to go over.
Now look, so see, I'm adding a little bit to this table here just to make it a little more interesting.
A little more roughing it up.
And then we forgot to paint that in too. So how you guys are standing in there with me, I just appreciate it.
Yeah, how long have we been at this?
It's just
only 1 hour and 49 minutes.
Well, I mean, for a painting like this, that's not that bad, is it? I mean, when you figure out starting it, I mean, when you think about it, you see kind of...
It's a good thing I did that background. We'd be over 2 hours by now. Look at the time I saved you.
I know. Thanks, John. You're a prince. You're a prince.
Hey, I can say I'm an acrylic painter now, right?
You can say that. You can say anything. Who's to stop you from saying anything? You sure could. Absolutely, you're an acrylic painter. I just pronounced you. All right, there we go. All right, so it's just here. Oh, I remember. We needed something here. This was coming. I keep
a comment
coming
came
to
in
that.
Will you fix the purple rope?
I just did.
The purple rope, the one in the back? Oh, it looks. Oh, they probably haven't seen it yet.
Oh, is this on a delay?
Oh, my goodness, yeah. We've had 4 or 5 interruptions.
Have we?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I did the very background. I did the, what was it, burnt umber. I did the burnt umber original underpainting.
Yeah, you did, right? And
John, when is the book? She's still writing it, kiddos. She's on chapter 4 of at least 13 chapters.
But I have to tell you, it's going to have lots of pictures in it, too, because one of the things I have discovered, I can't tell you how many art books I have bought over the years. You know, I'm an avid reader of everything. I read novels. I read stuff all the time. And, you know, there was a time when, back before Kindles, when I used to go to the bookstore and buy 4 or 5 books at a time, and if I was got down to 2 books, I'd panic and have to go back and get more. Because I couldn't, and my idea of a perfect vacation was give me a hotel room by myself with a book, right? Just stop talking to me, right? And now I do a lot of books on tape, and I listen to it while I'm painting and stuff. That's my little trick now. But I got to tell you that, where was I going with the books? Oh, one of the things I've discovered in all these art books, I have tons of them, right? And if they have a lot of writing in them, everybody goes, yeah, yeah, blah, blah. Yeah, yeah, blah, blah. What else you got? Give me a picture. Give me a few things I can use. What can I use right this second? You know, so we definitely are going to have writing, but we're going to have illustrations too. Because I know the kind of art, I guess I'm creating the kind of art book I like to read. How's that? Something that I feel, you know, and I hope you will too. But that's what I'm creating. Kind of art book that I personally think I would find useful. All right, so there's the top of that rope again, like that. Here's the top of this little pulley thing. Coming around here like this. We've got to chuck this under like that. Chuck this under like this.
Trying to think if there's anything else we need to tell anybody. Oh, we do have our paintings will be, not our paintings, Ginger's paintings will be going up for sale, hopefully over the weekend, and we'll have rules and regulations on how that will be done that you will want to make sure you look at before you jump in. But we're going to make it very affordable, we thinking, and ways to be able to get original Ginger paintings that will be signed by the author and comments written.
Anybody that buys one will get a personal thing from me on the, a note from me, personalized from me on the back of the canvas. I will do that so that you'll personalize it for me. Okay. And, I think we're doing pretty good here, John. I would say that, could we come back and age, you know, some of this old wood a little bit like this and come back here with some more cracks. And I would say a palette knife would have gone very well in here, too. I would say you could spend easily another hour playing with the highlights. And I'm not going to do it, but I appreciate you guys hanging in it. But I think you get the idea of how something like this is painted, right? And, and that's really...
And remember, this will stay up if you're fading off into the sunset.
And thanks, you guys, for those of you who hung in there with us.
Oh, I'm not a writer. Thanks for asking.
And, that's...
I'm a first-line editor.
But John is a very good editor. There we go. Just make that a little... Look at that, see? Just these funny little details like that. Just funny little things like that. There you go. You can come in wherever there's a light, there's a dark. Something's either dark or it isn't. And, you know, you got to go back. Acrylics dry darker. But sometimes you got to decide where you want something lighter and where you want something darker. Is it dry brushed? And then part of me would absolutely, you know, start with colors like this. Look, I'm adding just a little cad red medium in white. And just something like that. Can, you know, at the end, you come in with just a few fun little colors like that, just to add color. Everybody always says, I love the colors in your painting. Because see how I'm dry brushing on some old colors now? And dry brushing doesn't work unless you've got enough paint on there. I mean, what when you're trying to age something, you've got to have enough paint on the canvas for it to start to grab. That's one of the secrets that you've got. It doesn't. Otherwise, it's not real effective. All right.
And what time is your surgery tomorrow? High noon.
High noon. Oh, boo. High noon. Right.
Right at lunchtime.
Right at lunchtime. And so here's our little sort of the little highlights here. You know, like that, and this little bit of highlight up here, like this. Into our block and tackle. Here we go. Just something like that. A few little lighter highlights, just to. Add some pizzazz. All right. I think that we'll just, you guys got the idea of how you might paint a rope. And I wanted you to see, I was very excited because, again, I want to show you, let me just move this paint thing out of the way. I wanted to show you.
You bring the big one up again?
I want to show you the big one. I want to show you why you might want to learn to paint this, right? I mean, these are the kinds of things. Can you see the painting behind me? John, can you flash to the screen real quick?
Show can you flash to the screen?
Yeah, flash the big screen for a minute, right, behind me. Now look, do you see this painting behind me?
I do.
And you see all the texture and everything, that boat, see all the ropes, but you know, back this way. Wait. All right, can you see the ropes in here?
Yeah,
right?
I do.
And see the ropes up here?
I do.
Going up here, yeah. Like that.
And even the ones on the back holding the tires up.
Holding the tires up. This is how you'd paint that, all right? I mean, there's a reason why I'm showing you this stuff, okay? So now, look here. Let me just put this flat down here. Look here, just down on the table like that. Look at that. See this? See the block and tackle? That's what that is, right? See the chains going up? See the ropes? All the neat colors on the ropes? That's how you'd paint. And this rope over here, that's how you paint this. So I really wanted you guys to see how you might paint some ropes. That's kind of cool, isn't it?
It is cool.
I mean, I think that's cool. And generally speaking, there's all kinds of stuff that ropes might be on. And you don't always see all my original artwork, so you got to see that. And tomorrow we're releasing our coffee picture, which is where?
Hanging on the wall.
Wow, we're organized tonight. Hanging on the wall. All right. So that's,
hey, at least we know where it's at.
Well, yeah, we hung up all the paintings. Incidentally, we're not selling all our paintings. We're just selling some paintings. That made it sound like we're selling everything we own, like some sort of fire sale. We're really not. We're selling about 30, though. Maybe more. About 35 paintings we'll have for sale.
We're doing close to 30 a month. We're running out of room to store them all.
And we are selling a few, yeah. Here's a tiny one. All right, this is tomorrow. This is called Ode to Coffee. This
it
is
may
a special.
Be late because of surgery.
Yeah, John may not get this up till tomorrow evening, but because we got surgery tomorrow. But this will be our weekly release for our members. The horse was last week. I mean, we just keep changing stuff all the time for you guys. And I think this is, well, those of us who love coffee, this is one of my favorites. I hope you guys like it. And to sign one's name, one needs a little water on the brush. And
so will the two boats be a lesson? We have a two boat one right now, don't we?
These are not lessons. Ones behind us, these were paintings I did for my publisher, and these have been published and the prints have been sold all over the world, those ones that you just saw. Okay. And these are in my own personal collection now, the originals, which are not for sale, by the way. But, all right, so I just signed that. I think that's kind of cool. I hope you guys had fun with this. And again, part of me wants to just keep playing with this.
Yeah, but could you put painting. It down?
Some but I'm going to put the brush down. And I want to thank you guys for hanging in there with us on this fun Wednesday evening. And next time I see you, I'll probably be wearing sunglasses because...
Oh, that's right.
I can't... Once they do the other eye, they're doing the this eye.
The left eye.
The left eye. They're doing the left eye. And that I'm looking forward to it because the right eye, I see so much sharper out of the right eye. So I'm excited to get this done. I'm limited to time when I'm sure that this is now sort of common. You know, pretty much you get to a certain age and they say, by the way, we could fix your eyes. You're going, yeah, I don't know. Yeah, they can.
They can. They got the science to do it.
They got the science to do it. But I did ask the doctor this. I got to tell you this. I asked the doctor, I said, so how close are you to an eye transplant? You know what I mean? If they can do that. He says, 100 years away. We're not close to that at all, folks.
No.
That's what he said. Not close to that at all. But the fact that you can replace your lens is pretty cool.
Yep. Too much wiring goes on in the back of the eye.
That's what he said. Yep. Too much wiring.
So, all right, guys. Another fine evening with Ginger is coming to an end.
Good night.
And with that, we
Don't
bid you all.
Don't forget to subscribe. Likes, comments are appreciated. Thanks, you guys.
Bye.
Bye.
Night, Ginger.
Night, Sammy. Night, John.
And good night.
Where's
for
Sammy?
Studio
did
Beauty.
You show Sammy? Night, Sammy. Night,
Yo,
Sammy.
Sammy and the Gecko Friends.
Good night. Good night, John.
Good night.
Night, you guys.